All right, so welcome back to day two of our blogging for SEO class. If you are here new this week, remember to see me to get the enrollment code to add yourself to the class. And if you weren't here last week, let me show everyone where the syllabus is at, because I've also got some new handouts for you. We've got some items to work with today. So your computer should be on. You want to go to the desktop, so minimize everything, go to the desktop, and then open computer window at the top left corner, double-click computer. You want to then open the network location, classroom, data, drive Z, the Z drive in the network location, double-click that, and then scroll down to find our class, which is Campos Blogging. You teach more than one class, so make sure you go to the right class, Campos Blogging. Open that folder. The syllabus is there from last week if you'd like it, if you'd like a copy. The printer's off at the moment, so you can't print just yet. The notes that I wrote in class last time are also available for you there. They're dated with last week's date. I'll write some notes today and make them available in the network folder also by the end of the day. And I've got something new for us today, which is the blogging WordPress checklist. What you want to do is drag a copy of that from my network folder to your desktop or flash drive. Don't just double-click it in my folder. You want to drag it out of my folder into your desktop or flash drive. And so if you are new this week, those are the items there. You want to send me an email. My email's in the syllabus. If you want the lectures, I record all my lectures. If you've already sent me an email and I haven't replied to you, I'm going through my inbox and I'll get to you. And so that comes back over here, actually. I'm going through my inbox and I will be replying to everyone. If you asked for the videos, I'll be able to send them to you soon. We'll get started now. A quick reminder, if you haven't done so yet, please mute your devices if you haven't done so. And also about the food and beverages, no food and beverages in the room. I do have space over here to put them off to the side. So not on the desk, not on the side. Please take a moment to put those away. So we're going to talk about then what I have here pretty in-depth, and we'll actually do it, because what we did previously was we created a WordPress account over at wordpress.com. We're going to log in and work with it a little bit later, and if you've got your own website with your own blog, you can use it, but we created one last time. We're going to use it soon, but before that I want to talk about some conceptual things, and then we'll apply it. We'll apply those things. So that checklist that I gave you in the network folder, let's take a look at it. Again, the printer's off at the moment. You can print later. So I'm going to pull up that PDF, the blog checklist. We'll talk about it. I'll make some notes also. So I've got this two-page document divided into three sections: planning, writing, and promoting. The more of these you can do, the better. It's not that you have to do all of these things always, but these are things for you to think about to try to do as many times as possible to get you toward success. So on my checklist here, everything you need to think about when writing long-form blog content. Now I'm mentioning the term long-form blog content, which is synonymous with WordPress, but I also mentioned another type of blog, if anyone remembers from last week, the short-form blog, which is Tumblr. So just to remind you again, we're going to differentiate between the two: long-form blog, WordPress; short-form blog, Tumblr. We'll talk about Tumblr on the last day of class. And what we're talking about here in this handout does apply to some degree to Tumblr. But when we get to it, we'll see how different it is and similar. So we'll be focusing on WordPress for 3 days first, and then Tumblr the last day. And again, do as many of these as possible. 2 to succeed. I'm not saying do all of these things every single time. It's going to depend on various factors. But let's take a look at what these tips that I've got here. I've got the main sections: planning, writing, and promoting. Planning is what do you need to do to write. Writing is what or how should you write? And promoting is how do you get more people to read? Because you can write lots of stuff and you like it, but probably you want other people to also like it, or at least read it, think about it. Maybe share it. Or maybe you're using blogging. You want to make money from blogging. Remember, the syllabus has a link for a recommendation of a book over on Amazon, where you can get more advice about blogging, especially blogging for fun and profit. What's the title of it? It's something like Blogging Without Losing Your Soul. So if you check out that book in my syllabus, that might be useful to you. It's not a requirement. It's completely optional. And so that's what the third aspect is here, promoting. You've got to do a little planning, then you've got all of the writing to do, and then you need some promoting, also getting the word out to more people so that they can read it, they can comment, they can click, etc. So let's get in detail here. Decide on a hosted versus self-hosted solution. Will your site be on one of the free platforms, or will it be on your own server? So together in the class, we're going to use the hosted solution, in that WordPress.com is storing your blog, or Tumblr.com is hosting your blog. We're doing that simply so that we can have something to work with right away. The other way to do this is self-hosted. You yourself have to get your own domain, your own website. We'll talk about these things in detail, but we're going to focus first on the hosted version. And we talked pretty much in detail last time about this, but very quickly to say, hosted, the big idea about that is free, and self-hosted, not free. With hosted, it has limitations, and with self-hosted, no limitations. That's all we'll say about that. We talked about this in detail last time. But the big idea to think, number one, are you going to do it on your own site or someone else's site? They're both pros and cons. If you do it on hosted, you're giving someone else the traffic. You're giving WordPress.com the traffic. You're giving Blogger the traffic. You're giving Blogspot the traffic. You're giving LinkedIn the traffic. If you're doing your blog on someone else's site, you're giving them the traffic. In theory, if you go with hosted, you get the traffic. So right away there, perhaps that's a big no-brainer. Okay, I want the traffic myself. I'll set it up on self-hosted, but it's not free. There are no limitations, and you have to be in charge of it all. The security of it, the updates of it, all of that stuff. So I recommend, if you want a short answer, I recommend get self-hosted. That's the one that gives you the most power, the most ability, but yes, you are going to need to invest between $50 and $150 a year. It depends. Number two, develop a series concept. What can you write about in the long term? A blog should entice people to come back to your site time after time. Plan content that you would be happy to constantly write about. So I read a lot of articles that say that how to do blogging, how to start with blogging, and people get excited and they begin writing. And then they do pretty well and they write two or three or five or ten things. And then eventually you skip a week or a month and you skip another and you skip another, and then you're not blogging anymore. So all of the positivity that you got out of blogging now is waning. You're not reaping those rewards of visibility online, search results placement, traffic, sales, whatever. You're not doing it anymore. The search engines are not paying attention to you anymore. It's a self-defeating cycle. So the way to defeat the self-defeating cycle is to have a series that you can write. What can you write about in the long term? We talked about that the last day, the last little bit of time at the end of the last day. We kind of, in general, thought about concepts about what you could blog about, what you could write about in the long term, because you'll have to develop one or more concepts to write about constantly or on a long-term basis. So think of 2 to 5 ideas to write about in the long term. So we talked about lists. We talked about what else? Tutorials. It's in the other notes. We talked about things that we can write about in the long term. I can make another list of things, and that's an article. I can make tutorials on a regular basis. That's stuff to write about. I can write commentary. I can write opinions. I can write spotlights. I can write whatever. But I have to do it on a long term. Think in direct concepts and tangential concepts. Meaning, I've got Victor's Bakery, fictional business, so I can think of plenty of food articles to write, recipes, tutorials, but tangential stuff, stuff related to my main cooking topic. I could think about writing these spotlights of my employees. They work in my bakery. They might be interesting. They might have a story about food. They might have advice. They might have something that I can write on a regular basis. So I can write a tutorial this month. The next month, I'll have a spotlight post. Then the next month, they go back to tutorial. The following month after that, I might have like commentary on my opinion of the state of the organic food world. And then the next month after that, another recipe. So I'm just kind of jumping to different topics on the long term. Maybe the tutorial or the recipe is the long-term one that I can write one of those every month or every other month, and then I can sprinkle in between a different concept. But the thing about it is, keeps your traffic up, and the traffic to your site then could lead to other good results. Related to the concept is variety. Within your niche of expertise, plan on writing on a variety of related topics. Instead of always writing about one subject, plan on also writing on two or three related ones. So that relates again there to number two. We're going to see that some of these concepts in the handout overlap with each other to various degrees. But again, here, what I will say is alternate content to keep away writer's block. You're going to burn out eventually. You're going to, maybe before this class, you've looked up advice or articles on blogging, and it's all over the place. My own lessons and content are my opinions, my experience. Everyone's got their own experience, their own opinions, how to do this right. Everyone's right, everyone's wrong. Because it depends on what's good for you and your business. And so you often read tutorials that say, make sure you're blogging every week, or you're dead in the water. Now, that's a very extreme position. It has some truth. But the point is that if you're going to be blogging every week, you need to come up with something every week. You're going to get to that writer's block faster. So if you alternate to different kinds of concepts, types of posts, that'll keep you from getting bored. When you're bored, you won't do it anymore. When you're not doing it anymore, you're not getting any more traffic. Part of the way to get that variety is thinking about doing it solo or not. Are you going to write everything yourself? Are you going to have other people in your organization write as well? Are you going to have ghostwriters, guest writers, paid writers? So that is something to think about. Are you the only person that's going to write these blogs, or is also John in accounting going to get that task? That's a possibility, but what I say about getting other people in the business to write is, do they want to write? Do they know how to write? If you say no to either one of those, I wouldn't recommend getting John from accounting to also help you write. Let John from accounting do the accounting. That's what they were hired for. So if you're going to have other people in your company also contribute writing, make sure they can do it and they want to do it, or else it'll show in the result. If they don't want to write, they're going to write badly just to get it done, and then that blog might not be as helpful or as useful to you as the ones written by people that do want to write in your organization. So we'll say here, recruit organization members to help write, but they must want to write. They must want to contribute and use their skills and abilities so that the blogs are good results. Don't saddle someone that's already doing another job with yet another job. Yes.
You recommend having a style guide for them or review or editor for them or something?
Yeah, that's what I'm getting at with these other ones right here too. But that's a very good point, because if they're going to write, do you want them to be in their voice or your voice? That also relates to this over here. Are you going to have ghostwriters, guest writers, paid writers? So ghostwriters would be other people that write for you, but you take the credit, basically. And guest writers are that you invite other people from another company or another blog, whatever, to write on your site. Are they going to take credit or you take credit? And then we've got paid writers. Are you going to pay people per word, per article, whatever, per contract to write for you? So all of these ideas to think about. So ghostwriters, others write for you, you take credit. Yes.
You don't want a blog to toe like the company line though. You don't A blog shouldn't be like as formal as a press release or something else. Isn't it supposed to be a little bit more?
I think I took your question two different ways. Yes, you do want to toe the line. Your blog is all about how great your company is, but you don't have to write it as a boring press release. So I
Okay.
think that's two different things. You definitely want to write about your site, about your blog, about your company, about your product, of course. But it can be very informal or formal or fun or any kind of way you want to write it.
Because you know what I see a lot of times when I read blogs from other companies? It sounds like somebody in marketing just took what they took from a press release and just copied it and put it
Yeah,
on there.
yeah.
Yeah.
Based on
And
that.
then it's just repetitive and boring.
Yeah, so.
I thought blogs were supposed to be just a tad bit less formal. So it's like.
Blogs can be anything. A blog is a very generic term for any online writing on a site. So the blog can have anything, can be anything. So then it's up
But
to
do you
us
get a
to make
different
a good.
perspective from an employee there or somebody else that would be less likely you'd hear from, you know?
Well, yeah, but that's going back over here about different ideas, alternate content, who else is going to write. So you're going to have one of your other employees writing, sure, but then getting to these things over here, how are they going to write? What are they going to write? Is it completely in their voice? If it's completely in their voice and every other article is in a different voice, is that good or bad? I can't say. It's just that it's very open-ended. What to add to your blog, that's the good and the bad about it. But definitely, if you see too many blogs that are boring and press releasey, don't do that. because you're not liking it, other people are not liking it. Therefore, you want to write something that you like that other people will like as well. Guest writers, other people write, may take the credit. Meaning, whatever agreement you've got with your guest writers, they can have their name in it, they can have a byline, this was written by whatever, or not. Someone can write it for you, they take no credit, it's up to you to decide how you're going to make this arrangement, these arrangements. Paid writers, just about the same as before, other people, and then may take credit, and it's going to cost you some amount. What's the going rate? It ranges so much. I can only give you experiences that I've had in my company and such, but you can of course look this up online, and no one's got the straight answer, because depending on where you're writing, what you're writing, who you're writing for, what your experiences are, this is going to cost different amounts of money. But I've seen throughout the years, someone could be writing, you know, one article at a time for $20. Or someone could be writing it for $50 a shot. Or someone could have a contract, a retainer. For $1,000, I'm going to write X amount this month or this quarter. So there's such a huge range, I can't tell you what's good or bad. Do you guys have any opinion maybe out there that have done it or have heard about rates? So again, it's up to you to decide what's good with a particular client. Those are some possibilities. $50 an article, $50 for a package of three a month or a quarter or whatever. It's just up to you to negotiate it with the potential client. So if you decide on having other people working, ghostwriters, guest writers, paid writers, then we get back to the question about decide on style. That would be style guide. It's some sort of document, formal, informal, better yet formal, that it's written down that if you're going to write for us, you need to do it this way. And this is so open-ended as well, in that whenever you write something, make sure you've got a section, and then a heading, and then a section. Or it could be, whenever you write, make sure you do not use contractions. You know, whatever style you want your content to be in, it should be defined, if it matters to you, so that everything is in that voice. That, however, could get homogenous, in that everyone is writing the same way, same content, same design. That might be boring, might not work for your company. So style guide, I would say it's optional. Decide on style guide if necessary. It's up to you to decide if it is. There's no right or wrong answer. It's your content. It's your site. So that's a consideration, especially when you're dealing with other people. That's the first section here about planning. These are the things to think about before you write anything. So any questions on this first section?
Another thing that I saw someone do on the blog is to ask for writers, but not to pay them, but this is be a sample for your portfolio.
Sure. That could be a valuable way that you have other people contribute to your site, and what you're giving them is exposure, and that's good and bad. I see both sides of it all the time. I'm on the receiving end sometimes that I want to do something, and someone says, well, we can't pay you, but this will look great on your portfolio. Portfolio doesn't pay the rent. So for the one person, that's great. For the other person, not so good. But there's a give and take, and that's definitely viable, and that's definitely something to figure out with whoever you want to work with.
Sure. Just trying to crack into the business,
yeah.
I think it's an opportunity to build a sample, to build a portfolio,
yeah,
to be paid.
I think that's a really good point there. For younger people that are getting started off, and that's the catch-22 for everyone starting off. Well, I can't get this job because I need experience, but I need the job to get experience. So that is a viable thing to do. Let's look at the second section here, the next section then, on writing. This was planning, and we've got writing. Actually writing. Let's say you figured this stuff out. Now it's time to write. So we've got these ideas of frequency, length, title, description, etc. Because if I talk about the first section, I'm sure people are ready to ask, well, how often should I blog and how much should I blog? It's right here. Frequency, no matter your schedule, the important thing is to blog consistently. Start off with a once-a-month blog if you're not used to it. Once a week is better, once a day is best. So the point is, the more you do it, the better. The more content you're creating, the better. The more content Google will find, Bing will find, Yahoo will find, whatever way someone is searching, that search engine can find you if there's more content for the search engines to find. So short answer, blog often. And often is better than nothing. Often is better than once a year, better than once a quarter, better than once a month, better than once a week, better than once a day. All of that is better than the rest. Some of the most popular blogs, and you might not have thought of them as blogs, but the websites that you visit that often have something new, they probably have something new every day, or two things new, three things new every day. Those sites, however, often have a stable of writers, either in-house people, those that they get as ghostwriters, those that they get as paid writers. The more blog posts, the more content for the search engines to find, so that your site could be found. I wrote this article, the one I'm working on that made me late to class, was that I'm working on investment advice for millennials. So you're a millennial, you haven't thought of retirement because it's 50 years away, 90 years away. Well, it's going to get here eventually. You're going to need to retire eventually. You don't want to work all the time. I'm putting together this blog with, you know, some bullet points. Make sure you do this, 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 and this. And that will help you in the long term. So that and other blog posts that we create for our site get us traffic. That traffic comes to the site. We could then get consultations or leads, and then maybe sales, more clients. So it's content that helps you get found, and the more of it, the better. Okay, if you're going to do this often, let's say, okay, great, I want the best results. I'm going to do it every day. Well, think about a length here. If you're new to blogging, 100 words on a regular basis is a good start. 300 is better. If you blog more than once a month, you can vary between 100 and 300 words per post. So here's the beginner. If you want concrete answers, 100 words per month. So in 1 year, do you think in 1 year you can create 1,200 words? Probably. You have a whole year to do it because you're only going to do 100 words a month. You're going to see that you can get to 100 words pretty quickly. So, intermediate. Um, 100 words per week. Right here, you're going to be crafting about 400 words a month. 400 times 12 months is a big number. So you're going to be creating more content out there.
So this is raising the bar math more now. Can you write more, but on a regular basis?
And that advanced. X words per day. Because that is a big challenge.
Every day you're going to write something, and you could be writing 20 words, sure. 20 words times 30 days, 600 words a month, times 12, 600 times 12, it's more than 6,000. So you're creating lots of content if you're doing it that much every day. The higher levels here get you closer, get you faster to writer's block, to boredom, to burnout. So I would recommend, you're going to see plenty of articles that say, make sure you write 500 words all the time. That's right, that's wrong. It's up to you. How much are you going to create? How much can you create on a regular basis? The more straight answer is regular basis. How often can you create something? Can you write something? So great, make yourself a goal of these higher levels. But I would recommend start on the basic one, see how that goes, and then as you get more comfortable and feedback and results, then increase it.
Once you get to these higher levels, you'll probably have to have other people help you write. The actual content considerations then, here's a few of them coming up here. Title, description, images. Title. Try for a short, memorable, and direct title. Think in terms of content that people need and want to read. Example, my review on the Toshiba T75, a winner. So that's a title that I'm writing for a blog post. It's got the keywords and concepts that I want, that I think people will search for, such as review Toshiba T75. Now, does that matter that it's a laptop or a cell phone or a cordless razor? It doesn't matter what the thing is. It matters that people would be searching for it. And how would they be searching for it? So this is going to take us to these concepts that we'll revisit several times of think in terms of search terms, so keywords. Think about writing content. Think about creating content in the terms of what people are searching for. Put yourself in their shoes. Let's say I have a blog about comics, which I do. I want people to read that. I like comics. I've been collecting them for 30 years. I want to share what I know about them and my interests and all of that. Other people are interested in comics too. What am I going to write about? How am I going to write so that people, when they search for something, they can see my article? So maybe someone's writing, what's the best Spider-Man story? That's an idea that I can write about in my blog. That's a title. The top 5 Spider-Man stories of all time. That shows off there, that particular concept in the title. Because the search engines are going to look at all of this stuff of your posts. The search engine, Google, Bing, Yahoo, etc., will look at your title and put it into their database so that when someone searches, you could appear. They're going to look at your description also. But the title, so think in terms of search keywords. Think in terms of questions. Yes?
Okay, so now when that title comes up with 160 characters, if I like that blog and I wanted to tweet it, it's 150 characters. So what does that do to its marketability as far as Twitter is concerned?
What I'm saying here is 100 words.
No, I'm talking about your title.
Oh, the title,
yeah.
Yes.
So now I found it. It has 150. And I said, wow, this is really good. I'd like to share it on Twitter. Mm-hmm. But your title has 150 characters. I can't even add anything, mm-hmm. you know, that I want to add to the title because you can only use 140 for Twitter.
Yes, so that is a big consideration about the length of your titles to some degree. This title here, would you consider that?
I would take out mine. Okay, so review on Toshiba, take out all of the articles, take out the, and then definitely a just winner. That's dwindling it down to maybe more reasonable, you know, editing it down so that you could tweet it.
I think you're thinking too literally. I think those are valuable things you've said. I think you're thinking very good in terms of SEO and the literal limits of Twitter. But at a certain point, you're sounding too much like a marketer.
Yeah.
If you are just whittling it down to review Toshiba winner, that tweet sounds too marketing speak. It sounds too much like it's been super crafted like that. So there is that balancing act that we're all going to have to do. Because I think this whole title, I would use the whole title itself on Twitter. That's probably like 30 words. I still have more than 100 to work with, at least. Plus the link, that takes away another 20, let's say. I probably still have 60, 70 characters to work with. I can still write some opinion saying, hey everyone, check out this great new article that we wrote. The whole title and the link, and it'll probably fit. There are ways to put all of that into a very compact tweet, but definitely cut it out and whittle it to what you want. But what I'm saying is, what you actually write on your site, this is perfectly fine to have on your site, and to then, when you tweet it, yes, whittle it down and craft it for it to fit in the tweet.
Okay.
So Something about questions in your titles. I think I showed the example last week of one of the clients, the Mexican food restaurant that has a lot of rather exotic food. And you think, well, what is huitlacoche? Someone searches for that. It comes up number one on Google. There's an article. The number one article often is my client, because that's what people are searching for, that exact phrase. The client has a blog with that exact phrase in the title on their site. It's getting them good traffic. It's one of the most trafficked pages on that client's site. In addition to the title of a blog post, we have to think about writing a description. In about 150 characters, you should be able to explain what your post is about to people who come across it in search results. Entice them to click and read. This is another one where you've got a little bit of space to catch people's attention. Because when someone searches on any search engine, let me just go over here, all the same to various degrees. I'm going to go over here on Bing. I'm going to search how to retire. And so you're seeing all these results. There's your title. It's going to get cut off at a certain point. Then you've got this description here that gets cut off at a certain point, depending on the search engine. So this is what I'm talking about on that point, number four. What can you write right here to catch people's attention? When you've got 21.5 million results, how are you going to catch people's attention with just that snippet there? That's the description that we need to think about. In about 150 characters, which is about the length that we have on this description area, what else can you write about your article to entice people? So, this can be taken from what you have written already in the article and just fit it into the description space, or it can be something different but still think in terms of keywords. So I would recommend try to handcraft the description for maximum impact. Use keywords. I had searched for how to retire, and we saw that those keywords are appearing. Retirement, how to retire, retirement advice. So take that spot right there to add more of these possibilities of what people could be searching for. We will see in WordPress, again, we're talking about this all conceptually, then we'll do it in a little while. We'll actually log into WordPress, we'll see where to do it, how to do it, so you can actually apply it tangibly. Five, images. Choose images that relate to your topic. Use your own original images or appropriate stock images, also known as royalty-free images, public domain images. Visit this website for some that are okay to use. On a technical level, make sure your file names are meaningful and you've added alt text to each. So there's a lot to think about here. Number one, think about adding some images to your post. 1, 5, 10, 50, whatever, to a degree, but think about at least one image on your posts that relate to the concept, to the topic of the post. So you might say, okay, well, I don't have any pictures, I'm not a photographer, I don't have a good camera, I'm going to do a Google search, I found the perfect picture, I'll add it to my site, I'm done. Right? No, that could be a problem. It could be a problem for simply do searching on Google and Bing and Yahoo to find the perfect image. That could be a problem because you could accidentally be stealing someone's picture. Just because you find a picture, and just because you have the button to download it, doesn't mean you should. That's going to look great on my blog post. I'm going to steal it. Literally, you could be stealing it. What's that?
You see where it says license? Mm-hmm. It says free to use, domain, so it'll tell you whether you can use it.
Very good point. How many of you, before that was pointed out, ever saw that? Very few people. That's a very good point that you pointed it out, but many, many people are not even going to know that. They're not going to know what a license is, driver's license. But this is a good point, because what I'm saying in the notes here is you want to deal with images that are stock images, royalty-free, public domain, images that are okay for you to use. So my short answer is I don't recommend people to do searching on a regular search engine unless they know what they're searching for. So it's a great idea here to then say, show me only public domain images. And
then it decreases your...
It definitely decreases it. And unfortunately, what
does this have to do with retirement? What does this have to do with retirement? What does this have to do with retirement? So that's still not a perfect solution, but it's much better than before.
Exactly.
Public domain images.
Do the free to share and use. That will come up with that one.
These could work pretty well, perhaps. Yep, that one really makes sense. So here's one way to search. Make sure you search the right way. But that's why I make it easy here also, in that I have a link to this search engine, this website, pixabay.com, where I'm recommending come here. You're not going to see a million results, but all of the results that you're going to see are specifically targeted to be free, high-quality images. Over 630,000 free stock images, vectors, and illustrations. Free images and videos you can use anywhere. So this one definitely then negates the problem of, can I use this picture? Did I search for it right? Because everything here is high-quality, downloadable, and you can use it for commercial and non-commercial entities. When we look at some of these other results on the search engines, and some of these say free to modify, share, and use commercially. Free to share and use commercially. So if you're trying to make money off of your blog and you're using these images, you know, you perhaps chose one that wasn't okay for that purpose. If you go to a place that is all about, like this, being safe, everything I get here is going to be great for my non-commercial blog and my commercial blog, and technically I can get the picture here and print it out nice and big and put it on my wall of my business. I can use it as a poster to get more sales for my business. This is a completely open site with a lot of great content. The big drawback is that it doesn't have millions of results. But hopefully out of those 200 cats that you see here, you find the perfect one. Hopefully out of those $40 logos, you get a good one. So either search correctly, meaning put your keyword plus public domain, or royalty-free, what I've got in my notes there, royalty-free, stock image. So search for what you're looking for, plus, in quotes, the modifying keyword, so that it's houses, public domain. So that's where you're guiding the search engine of what you want. The search engines are getting smarter and smarter, but still, they're going to show you a lot of irrelevant stuff. Or go to sites that specialize in this, like Pixabay. Does anyone know other sites that are all about stock images and stuff like that? Free images, royalty-free? Yes.
Sometimes on Wikipedia and
Commons. Yes. Pull that one up. Commons, Wikimedia. Okay, so Wikipedia, the big encyclopedia, often has a lot of free pictures to work with. The direct address for that, remember all of these notes that I'm writing, I'll put them for you in the folder. commons.wikimedia.org. Wikimedia is the larger parent organization for Wikipedia, which is the free online encyclopedia. Wikimedia is the larger organization where you can find news and graphics and all of that for free. So if you go here and you search, you'll get lots of results as well, varying quality, but a lot of them, or most of them, should be also okay for you to use. And this is very draconian or very strict, but I would say when in doubt, don't use it. I would not want you to get into any sort of trouble, because it's very easy in the real world, like, oh, you took that money out of my wallet, clearly you stole it. In the online world, you took that picture off of my website, you stole it, technically. And a lot of people, maybe we've grown up or we've used the internet for a long time thinking, yeah, it's online, you can share it, great, no problem. Intellectual property still exists online. Short answer is, if you didn't create it, don't assume that you can use it. And yes, there's the whole gray area of social media, which I'm not going to get into. But the short answer is, on your blog, always think in terms about what are you writing that is the most original and yours, especially when it comes to pictures. Because you could have taken that picture of these birds off of Google, and that came originally from some photographer's website that is making money off of their pictures, and you just took it from them, and technically you stole it. So I've got here further, on a technical level, make sure your file names are meaningful. Now, this is something that we also have to think about, in that short answer is, your file names should also have keywords. When you take a photo out of most cameras, the file that comes out of it is something like img_0023jpg. Or something like, you know, NK dash the date 1.png, whatever. You get some graphic with some weird meaningless name out of your camera, usually sequential number. You should think about that as well when you upload your photos to your blog, and instead change them to cat JPEG or how to raise a cat.jpg. That's kind of an extreme example there, but think in terms about, don't use just the generic numbers. The search engines look at that too. The search engines look at everything about your site, even the file names on your graphics. So at the very least, I would call this, for example, Calico Cat. What's in the picture? What's the picture about? Either name the picture about what's in the picture, or what's it about. I personally, what I do is, because you might want to use a picture more than once, and that's fine, I usually do it like this. I leave the original number of the picture, and then I put my keywords into the picture. This is for me to find the picture again, because every picture that I photograph, I store it somewhere on my hard drive. And so if I want to find that picture again, let's say I needed the high quality version. Let's say I shrunk this cat picture down small. I need the high quality one again. My digital camera made a picture called image0028, not a picture called Calico Cat. So I leave the original file name so that I can find it again in my backups. That's optional, but I recommend that, and it does work for us in my company. So this one is something like kids playing, and then, you know, whatever way you want to do it. I'm leaving part of the file name on that one,
because this I can search my backups and find this, but this is now separated from the original graphic, and if I do that, I'll never be able to find the original graphic again if I need to work with it again.
And then the third thing in this number 5, alt text. I'm going to say use alt text. alt text are embedded descriptions into your pictures. When we get into WordPress, we'll do it. But the concept of alt text is it's a description that's attached to a picture. It's a description that's attached for accessibility purposes. So I'm going to say picture descriptions for accessibility. Accessibility is making your content usable, accessible by everyone. You may be surprised to know that people that are completely blind can still visit websites, can still buy products online, can still enjoy content online. You might say, well, if they're blind, how can they see what's on the screen? How can they know where to click if they're blind? A person has that is blind has usually some sort of software or hardware that reads them what's on screen. I can have a screen reader that when I visit a website, it'll start to say navigation, home link, about link, contact us link, shop link. And then they have a keyboard that they've memorized to know that they can then jump quickly to something and press enter and it clicks. Like if I can see it, I can click it. So the screen reader reads a website to a person. They can then navigate the site. The problem comes when the screen reader gets to a picture. Because the screen reader can process all of this text, but when it gets to this picture, if it's not set up properly, the screen reader will simply say, picture. Meaningless. Yes, the search engine and the computers are getting smarter to analyze what's inside of a picture. But don't assume that's going to help you for another few years. The search engine might be able to say, there's birds here. Maybe it can analyze that these are the blue-footed boobies. But what if these are two specific blue-footed boobies that are in the San Diego Zoo with names? What if this is a photo of a family portrait? There's no search engine that's going to know who's in the photo. So alt text is something that we could and should add to our pictures that may not be visible on screen for people that are sighted, but is accessible to people that are not. If I'm blind and my screen reader is reading to me and the designer has put alt text on that picture, the computer will read and read and read and say, picture, blue-footed boobies. Click here. So alt text is something that you should do. We'll see how to a little later, but it's pictures for accessibility, because don't you want everyone to be able to manage your site, regardless if they can see or not? Don't you want everyone to read your articles? Do you want everyone to buy your products, to enjoy your content? And that's just a little bit of accessibility. For government entities, this is the law. Government entities, local and state, federal, etc., need to be accessible. They need to be accessible by everyone, regardless of impairments of visual, physical, mental, etc. For private entities, it's not a requirement, but if your competitor's website is accessible and yours isn't, the search engine might guide people to that one. People might get sales on your competition because yours is not accessible and people leave. The search engines are pretty much making this, even though it's not a law, the search engines are pretty much making this a requirement nowadays for every website, even if you're not a government entity. So my advice for that is describe a picture like for someone on the phone. Let's say you have a friend, perfect 20/20 vision, but they're on the phone. How would you describe that picture to them on the phone if they can't see it? Well, it's a picture of birds. That's good enough. Better yet, it's a picture of these rare blue-footed birds. So a simple sentence, you don't need a whole paragraph, a simple sentence attached to the picture to describe it. This is very important nowadays for SEO. We've got headings. Take advantage of headings like H1, H2, etc. They are useful for breaking up a wall of text into readable sections and help search engines understand your content. So on my syllabus, there's an example of that. From a distance, you can't really understand what my syllabus tells you. But from a distance, you can see that it's divided into chunks, into sections. Each of these is a heading. Heading number one. We're going to talk about headings in detail. They don't have to be numerically in sequence. Heading one, heading two, heading three. Don't worry, we'll get to the details of it. But there's heading one, heading three. We'll talk about the detail. But the point is, we're dividing our content into logical sections. Because nowadays, we are seeing that people have a lot to do. They have shorter attention spans. They might not read your whole 500-word magnum opus, but you've made a section that says the gist, and they jump directly there and they read that. Good enough. They read the important stuff. Maybe you had a section up on top here, step one, step two, step three, heading one, heading one, heading one. You have these headings to divide the content into bite-sized chunks. With no headings, this is just a big, boring, huge wall of text, which people will then give up reading faster. People are already going to give up reading your content. And think about yourself. Do you read every word of what you read? Or do you kind of skim a little, jump to the important thing that you think is important? Do you go back? Do you go forward? If you take advantage of that, we can guide people. This is the most important thing. It's big and bold and stands out. We made it a heading. And the search engines love those. The search engines love it when you set your content into headings, because it shows the search engines that you know what you're doing, and that you're organizing your content, and therefore the search engines can rank you better. I'll say, use headings. Use headings to guide people to read your content. So break it up into chunks, into sections, you know, two paragraphs or so in this one heading section, maybe one more paragraph in another heading section, whatever makes sense for what you're writing. Just break it up into sections with headings. And I'll say search engines. I usually say search engines generically. I don't say Google, you know, generically, because people use Google, people use Bing, people use Yahoo, etc. So search engines like headings. And when a search engine likes something about your site, that could mean you get higher ranking, because your competition perhaps is not doing it. You're doing it. Search engine likes that. They'll rank you higher, potentially. Again, all of these things, I'm not saying always do them. For example, it might not make sense in the 100-word article that you're writing to put headings. If it doesn't make sense, don't do it. But if it makes sense that my first 50 words will be this chunk, heading, and then my second 50 words will be this second chunk, put a heading. Lists. If you're going to use lists, either bullet points or numbered lists. They're useful because they create bite-sized pieces of content that people can consume easier. Your title may derive from the type of list you've written. For example, the top three best WordPress tutorials. So if it makes sense on what you write, you could then put a list. I've got bullet points on my syllabus right here. I've got a section called Student Learning Outcomes, and then five bullet points of what you hope to accomplish by the end of the course. So I can put a list of content like that. Quick information, bite-sized pieces, people are drawn there, they read it, and if they get the most important thing out of it, mission accomplished. If not, they can then go back and read some more, and they still read your content. Bullet points or numbered lists are good. So we'll see. Bullet or numbered lists as needed. Not every blog needs that, But if it makes sense for you to divide a list of things, instead of making it one big paragraph, see if you can divide it into smaller chunks with bullet points or numbered points. Links. A relevant internal link to your own blog post on your own site is helpful for keeping people on your site longer. A link to an external link to someone else's blog is helpful when trying to get backlinks. When setting external links, remember to make them open in their own tab. So we have the concept basically of internal links, external links. Keep people on your site longer. Used for getting backlinks. Someone reads one of my articles about finance. That might not be enough for them to be convinced that I know what I'm talking about to hire me. So if I have a link within my article that also says, don't forget to check out our other top 10 list on X. They click on that link, it goes to one of our other articles about finance. They get more information, they see perhaps they do know what they're talking about. Maybe I will reach out for this free consultation. Maybe I will hire them.
So the longer you keep someone on your site, the closer they could be to completing the objective of your site. Simply to get views, to click on an ad, to send you an email, to donate, to hire you, whatever. Keep people on your site longer to have them complete your goal, whatever it may be. External links are used to get backlinks to bring you more traffic. Backlinks can be called backlinks, incoming links, inbound links. They're basically links from some other website back to your website. So the search engines look at that. The search engines see this site has 10 links, external links. This site has 2. The search engine will want to give more preference to the one that has 10. Now there's a whole nuance about all of that which we get into the SEO class. But the concept is the more relevant links back to your site, the better. Because that's sort of like people vouching for your site. If some other site links to your site, most likely it was for a good reason. You had good content that some other site linked to you and referenced you. For example, again, that client that has that article about Huitlacoche. A lot of other websites link to that article because they want to write their take on Huitlacoche, but they still link back to our article on Huitlacoche as a reference or to bolster their point. The search engine see that, and then it helps. So the other website won't know your website exists. In my social media class, I talk about this over and over. If you want to get more followers on Twitter, follow accounts. Some will follow you back, because now they know that you exist. You want to get more followers on Facebook? You like other accounts, because then they will be made aware of you, and they might follow you back. Now, it's not a perfect one-to-one follow back. But if I link my website to someone else's website, they get a notification, usually, especially if it's a WordPress site, then my site linked to their site. And the least that could happen is that that other website sees that there's a link, says great, and moves on with their day. The best thing that could happen is they come back to my site to read some articles, giving me some traffic, and then the best case scenario is that then that other site links back to my site because I've got some great content that they can link to. So phishing for backlinks via external links is a way
to get links back to your site. It will not always be one-to-one, meaning that I link to those seven sites and seven of them will link back to me. Maybe I linked to seven sites and two link back to me. That's still a win. Two links back to me as I'm building my backlinks. And then we've got organizing. Set up categories and tags, as well as author pages. Use categories as the largest organizational unit. Cakes, pies, cookies. And tags as the fine-tuned organizational units. Chocolate, sugar-free, birthday. This concept is always kind of hard to explain for beginners. Categories and tags. But basically, you can think of categories as the folders or the big concepts where your blogs are put into, your blog posts. This particular Victor's Bakery is going to write about a variety of things. And I could have some articles about cakes, some about pies, some about cookies. So anything related to the cakes articles are categorized as cakes. I might have chocolate cake articles, chocolate cookie articles. What's the commonality there? Chocolate. So both of those are in different categories, but they both use the same tag. Chocolate. That's how you can have separate concepts but still be linked together. So I will say, use categories and tags to organize, to make searching your site easier. Someone visits your blog, it shows there that you've got four pages of articles. They're not going to click next, 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 perhaps. Perhaps they're going to search. They're going to search for a keyword. If you put that keyword of a tag or a category attached to your post and someone searches, again, they can find your stuff internally. Because there's Google searches and there's searches in your site. WordPress has search built in to your site. And if you organize your content, people can find it. That's what Google and Bing and Yahoo are doing 24 hours a day. They're looking at all the websites of the world and organizing them by keywords and content. So your own site should have organization in order for people to find stuff in your site. So I will say pick 1 to 3 maximum categories per post. Pick 5 to 10 maximum tags per post. This is just other ways of getting keywords attached to my posts. But if I can get it in one category, great. I wouldn't go more than 3 because then you're diluting it. You're putting too many separate things out there, perhaps. They're not going to be linked together. You're not going to get adequate result. If you're putting 7 categories on every article and someone searches one category, you're going to get so many results because they're all linked together. But if you judiciously use categories, 2 categories per post, there might be some overlap, but then there will be enough uniqueness for your content to be found. And same thing with tags. So I'm going to say, usually, this is just personal and my recommendation, usually pick categories before you write, and then usually pick tags after you write. I personally find that when I have to do this, I can think, okay, we've already defined these 10 categories. We've already talked with the client. We've done an analysis, a marketing strategy, and SEO optimization. We've already developed 10 categories that we're going to be writing about. So it's just a matter of picking the right category and writing something about it. But as we write, or as I write, then I start to write content and I figure out, okay, this keyword, this tag, I thought of to add to that article. Or, I remember, I used these three tags for that other article, and two of those might apply to this one as well, to link them together, so that they're found easier. You can do all of this beforehand, or afterward, or not at all. But in my checklist, I recommend to do as many of these things as possible. And all of these are in the service of getting you traffic and improving your SEO and hits and all of that, sales. Read more. On your blog page, only include a snippet of the post, perhaps with an image, and the option for people to read more, also known as continue reading. On the post itself, set up a way for related posts to be visible. This is better to show you, then I'll explain it. Let me just show an example, one of our sites, vmcinc.net/blog. So this site, social media, web design, and more, the blog has an article, build an Android app with HTML5. Another article, CSS3 drop shadow, quick tip, 15 years experience. So different articles, and they say something either like continue reading or read more, depends on the site, depends on the theme, etc. But here, okay, I'm not interested about that, but I'm going to go on, oh, I am interested in that, I'll read more. The reason I'm saying read more is the default behavior of WordPress is that all your 500 words will appear. Unless you cut it down to the first 50 and then read more. If you've got all your 500 words on every single blog post, you're going to have lots and lots and lots of scrolling. People are going to have to scroll lots and lots and lots to get from one article to the next. That might be annoying. So a smarter way would be to cut down to have some sort of intro, with a picture or not, but some sort of intro and a read more. We'll see in WordPress how to do that. So I'll say tease people with a snippet of content. Then read more. The people that do want to read more can click to read more. The people that don't want to read that can move on without annoying them that they have to scroll through the whole article. I do recommend this because the default in WordPress is that it doesn't do that. It has everything on one page. Keep people on your site with related posts. We can see that with WordPress, someone reads one of your posts, and as you add more content and organize it into categories and such, WordPress can then, at the end of the article, say, you read that, why not read this? You've seen that on sites as well, I'm sure. You read one top 10 list, and then here's another top 10 list you can read. And then I do, and I read three more. So keeping people on your site longer then helps accomplish the goal. That's what I'm saying here. On the post itself, set up a way for related posts to be visible. It's pretty easy with WordPress. I think it's on by default. Because WordPress is trying to help you get more people to read. Big section here, but any questions on the writing section? Right, last section, then we'll take a break. Promoting. Let's say you've spent all of this time, you've written a great post, no one's reading it because you didn't engage in the other aspect of it all, promotion. So it's not true, unfortunately. If you build it, they will not come unless you promote it. Promoting. So, promoting. Social for them, social for you. Make sure your readers can easily share to Facebook, Twitter, Google+, etc. If your content is good enough, people will want to share it, their friends to see, thus turning them into advertisers for you. Okay, so social for them means that they're on your blog, They read an article of yours, and somehow it has a mechanism for people to then share it on social media, on their social media. This person has a Facebook, and they want their programmer friends to also see this article. So they click Facebook, and this will open up the process for them to log into Facebook and to share my post on their Facebook. I want that. I want my stuff to be shared further out there. I want free advertising. That's free advertising there. There's a tweet button. Someone thought this was very cool. They can click tweet. And yes, this comes back to the issue earlier about, well, how much do I write? Because it's gonna condense it down there unless I do it manually. So give people the ability to share your stuff for you for more traffic. We'll see if we can do that in WordPress. We can do that in WordPress pretty easily. So that's let people become free advertisers for you. Make it easy to share everywhere. So Twitter, Facebook, Google Plus, Instagram, whatever. Make these networks available for people so that they can share it, giving you free advertising. On the flip side, social for you, share your content on your relevant social media channels. Share a link to your blog post on your personal LinkedIn or from the company Twitter, from the company Instagram, for example. So don't just let other people advertise for you. They might not if they don't know you exist. So you have to take the time and the effort to get people to find out about you. You should also have a Twitter or a Facebook or an Instagram or whatever makes sense for you and have time for. And on your Twitter, after you've written that article, tweet about it. All your 7 followers then become aware. All your 50 followers become aware. All your 1,000 followers become aware of it, and that could drive traffic to read that article back to your website. All of these social networks can be taken advantage in that way. I can post that article on my Facebook, on my Instagram, on my Twitter, on my Pinterest, on my YouTube, everywhere. Some you have to be more creative than others, because how are you going to post your article on YouTube? My article is text and YouTube wants a video. So what if I make a 30-second video of me talking, saying, hey everyone, I'm holding my camera here, hey everyone, I've just written a brand new article that you really need to read about how to retire, check it out on our website, follow the link below. Upload it to YouTube, there we go, I've got something to share on YouTube to get me links back to my article, my text article. So I'll say here, take advantage of all the free social media accounts. Share your posts everywhere. You can be using your personal Facebook or your business Facebook. That's fine. You just have to be careful about the personal one, and it's all up to you to use it or not. Because how many times are you going to bother your friends and family again that you've got another article on how to make money? They've read it already. They don't want to know about it. They're your friends and they're nice, but they don't want to know about it again. So if you're going to use your personal accounts for all of this, think about that. You're sending perhaps business stuff to your personal acquaintances, and they might not tolerate it for too long. You could also say, well, the kind of business that I have, it doesn't make sense that I also share it personally. That's fine. Don't create a brand new Twitter account just for the business. You'll have to then educate yourself about how to use social media professionally. Guess what? I'm teaching a class on social media. It's Tuesday nights. We just had day 2 to yesterday. We talked about Google Plus. There's still space in the class. There's still 3 more weeks if you're interested. Tuesday nights, 6 p.m., 9:30 p.m., 6 p.m. to 9:30 p.m. in room 209 upstairs. I'm teaching a social media class this month. Next week, we're going to talk about Facebook, the biggest social network. Come on in, there's still space for that. After that, we're going to talk about Pinterest, and then after that, we're talking about YouTube. So if you need to brush up on social media, I'm currently teaching a class. Comments. I believe comments are in a transition phase, so this may change at some point. Allowing people to comment on your posts could help generate more traffic. Remember to moderate, though. What I'm saying here is, remember last week we went over to browneyedbaker.com, I think, and we saw that they had a lot of great recipes there. And we saw that people were commenting, saying, that looks great, or here's my opinion, or whatever. But we also saw that some people had links back to their website. So they were taking advantage of that forum for someone to write something and getting a little free advertising back to their site. That might be valuable for you. Have the ability for people to comment on your posts. What I'm saying about might would be that the downsides could outweigh the upsides, which is that suddenly you're getting a lot of spam. These spam bots are writing all of this junk on your posts. Let's say you activated moderate posts in that nothing gets posted visibly until you approve it. That's much better. But now you have to be a moderator. Now you have to look at all of these messages and say yes or no. Spam, delete. So this one's highly optional. Use it if you're going to manage it. If you have the time to deal with another message that says, a new comment has been added to your post, click here to moderate it. Click here to approve it or deny it. And with WordPress, it'll send you an email. If you activate it, it'll send you an email. It'll show you the message, and right from your inbox, you can click approve, deny, spam. You can deal with it pretty quickly there. There's also a WordPress app. You can get the WordPress app and manage it all from your pocket. And finally, number four, guest blogging. Offer to post on other people's relevant sites. Add your expertise to their site. Your author page should have links back to your own blog, thus driving traffic to you. As you become more well-known in your niche, it will help your SEO. So let's see this example over here. RSConline.com. This is a comic book shop in Mission Valley. I guest blog there sometimes. There's an article here I wrote recently about this very funny comic book called I Hate Fairyland. And the point of this is I'm writing for someone else, but the point of that is that then there's links that I can get back to my website, that I can get back to my Twitter, because it's my byline. I have their my own author page. Everything that I've written is listed here. All my links are here. The point of this is some free advertising back to my site. I'm having someone else that is relevant. I mean, I'm writing on someone else's blog that is relevant to what my blog is about. And there's a link back to my blog there. So for you, what could be valuable is you need to find out about other relevant sites, maybe not your competitor, but other related sites. I'm Victor's Bakery, and I'm going to write an article about baking on some do-it-yourself craft site, because I can lend some expertise regarding food. And the point of that is I'm piggybacking on someone else's site that is perhaps more popular than mine. And then I've got links back from the article over there back to my own website. This, of course, means you have to have this arrangement all set up with that other company, because you're asking, can I guest blog for you? Can I write on your site? They say yes. Can I have an author page? They say no. They say yes. The author page is basically a page on their site about you with your links back to your site. So that's all the stuff you have to figure out with whoever you're going to guest blog for. Get traffic back to your site by piggybacking on someone else's more popular site. So whatever arrangement you set up, free articles, you know, at the minimum, you write a free article for them because you're going to have links back to your site. Or maybe you have some sort of monetary arrangement, or you have maybe service for service, in that you write something on their site, they'll write something on your site. You're both getting traffic back and forth in an organic way, because you're creating content that could be found. Not that you're doing Google Ads or whatever, you're doing it more organically. And then this is going to be showing you up more online. If you have that author page, if you have this known quantity, if you're this entity online, usually I'm writing under the pseudonym VM Campos. So I'm building a fame or a persona with that name online. So the more content that I put out there on my site, on someone else's site, on social media, the more I get found that way and get traffic back to my site, my own blog. So that's the section on promoting, stuff you have to do outside of your blog to get you more traffic. Any questions on that? I have here again the link, if it interests you, back to the optional book, How to Blog for Profit Without Selling Your Soul. You can get the paperback or Kindle version, and it's optional, but just more to learn, more advice. Very well rated. I try to provide stuff for classes that is well rated and well regarded. And there's a link there, so that's my handout for the moment. We're going to take a break in a moment. And then we're going to try to start to apply these things to an actual articles and such. Any general questions on what we've talked about today? We're going to take our break. When we come back, we're going to log into WordPress.com. So you might want to try to log into it to see if you remember your password and all of that. It's about 7. We took a slightly longer break because we had a long lecture. We'll do from 2:10 to 2:20, so about 13 minutes. We'll take a break until 2:20, and then we'll go on.